Hi, everybody. Welcome back. Wednesday's in the Word. It's good to have
Hi.
You with us again. All right, Olivia, you've got a joke to start us off again this week, right?
Yes. These are good. So I'm just continuing these. I like them.
All right.
Where is the first baseball game in the Bible? In the big inning, Eve stole first. Adam stole second. Cain struck out Abel. The Giants and the Angels were rained out.
That's a good one. That would have been a good one to do when we were doing the book of Genesis.
That would have been a good one.
Yeah, and I actually have, for the end tonight, I have part of a song to play, too, that's based on this chapter.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah. All right. So here we go. Let's begin with Acts chapter 12. Olivia, I'm going to let you start reading. You can read verses 1 through 10.
Okay. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Then the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes and sandals," and Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak round you and follow me," the angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed the first and second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself, and they went through it. When they had walked through the length of one street, suddenly the angel left him.
Carolyn, can you pick up and read 11 through 19?
Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I know without a doubt that the Lord sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were anticipating." When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, "Peter is at the door." "You're out of your mind," they told her. When she kept insisting that it was so, they said, "It must be his angel." But Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. "Tell James and the brothers about this," he said, and then he left for another place. In the morning, there was no small commotion among the soldiers as to what had become of Peter. After Herod had a thorough search made for him and did not find him, he cross-examined the guards and ordered that they be executed.
Okay, so let's talk about just this first section of chapter 12, and then we'll kind of address the end of it. First of all, we see at the very beginning here, when they're saying it was at this time, this was kind of at the time now that, as we talked about last week, where the mission to the Gentiles is spreading, and Saul and Barnabas are kind of traveling up into the area of Syria around Antioch. and spreading the gospel there and other places as well. So we see this spread, and the church is really established. We heard then last time that this is the first time that they're called Christians. And so the church really kind of is coming into its own. Now we hear from Herod again, and this is the same Herod who was in charge at the time that Jesus was put to death. It's not the same Herod that was in charge when Jesus was born, but it's the same one when Jesus was put to death, okay? So now we see kind of a, you know, up until this point, there's been resistance from the religious leaders. Herod is, I mean, he's called a king. He's not really, because of course they're still under the rule of Rome, but Herod is given kind of some political power to rule over Judea or this region here. And so Herod, now we see, joins the persecution of the church. So now the persecution starts coming from a political source. Up until this time, it's just been kind of a church thing, really. But now it becomes political. And the first thing that he does, that we're told that he does, is in verse 2, is we see now the second recorded martyr's death of one of the followers of Jesus. And this is James, the brother of John, who is put to death with the sword, is what we're told. Herod orders that he is put to death. He's the brother of John, who was the writer of John's gospel. And then it kind of moves on. Then in verse 3, it says, when he saw that this pleased the Jews, we need to understand that when they're referring to the Jews in this sense, they're talking about the Jewish religious leaders. These are probably members of the Sanhedrin who had continued to be in opposition to Christianity. And they were the people who probably were in power at the time when Jesus was sentenced to death. They were the ones who, the religious leaders who opposed Jesus as well. So Herod is gaining favor with them. He sees that this pleases them. So there, now we see these religious forces and political forces kind of join together. And then he has Peter arrested. Peter is the leader of the church in Jerusalem. And so for him to have Peter arrested and put into prison is a big deal. And we're told that he does this at the time, kind of at the beginning of Passover. And so he doesn't want to do anything with him until after Passover is over with. Passover is more than just one night. It's a festival that goes on for a longer period of time. And so he's going to wait until all of this is over with and then address it. Any comments or questions so far on that? All right, so then we get this in beginning in verse 5, this account of what happens when Peter's in prison. So Peter is kept in prison, but the church is continuing to pray for him. It's significant that we're told that the church continues to pray for Peter, that Peter be kept safe in prison. And so then the night before he's scheduled to come to trial from Herod, we're told that Peter is sleeping. And all of a sudden, we get this angel of the Lord appears to him and light shines around him. Now, in order to understand who this angel of the Lord is, it's important for us to kind of look at a little bit of kind of history. We see this term, angel of the Lord, appear many times in the Old Testament. And almost every time you see it in the Old Testament, this angel of the Lord, it's pretty much agreed that most of those instances, this angel of the Lord is a pre-incarnate Jesus. So it's actually Jesus in the Old Testament who is appearing to the people. In the New Testament, that shifts a little bit differently. And so when we see this angel of the Lord being referred to in the New Testament, then we understand that that is no longer Jesus, because Jesus, of course, has already appeared and been resurrected again. This more than likely then in the New Testament is one of the archangels, more than likely it's Michael. A lot of the times when we see this happening in the New Testament, this angel of the Lord, in these kinds of situations, it's kind of, there's a like a battle or a conflict or something going on. Michael is the one who is kind of in charge of the hosts of heaven or the armies of angels. Michael is kind of like what we would call the commander in chief of the army. What's the name for the like big general guy? I'm not very good at my military terminology, but the guy who
commanding officer.
Yeah, but he's on the cabinet and the president. I don't remember.
Oh,
you know what I'm talking. You know who I'm talking about? Like Donald.
The commander general or something.
Defense or.
Yeah. Anyway.
Everyone's gonna criticize.
I know everybody's probably gonna be commenting like, "Oh, it's this." Anyway, that's Michael. So probably in this instance, is what we're seeing is this is Michael. And because I think in the New Testament, they make distinctions. If Jesus shows up, like when Saul had this encounter on the road to Damascus, it was definitely Jesus that he encountered. And we were told that Jesus appears to him. So in the Old Testament, they wouldn't use Jesus because, of course, they don't know that that's who it is. And the Old Testament is Jewish scriptures, and they don't have this doctrine of the Trinity that we do. So the difference here kind of makes a shift in the New Testament, because these, of course, are Christian writers in the New Testament. All right. I probably spent more time on that than I really needed to. But Peter, then, as this angel of the Lord shows up, then the chains are released. They fall off of his wrists. And the angel then tells him, he says, put your clothes on and your sandals. And Peter follows his directions and then follows him out. And so they go out of the prison. Peter thinks that he's having a vision. He doesn't think that this is really and truly happening. He thinks he's dreaming this. And he doesn't realize that this is real until verse 11, when we're told, they're outside, and all of a sudden the angel leaves him, and Peter, it's almost like he's like, whoa, this is real. This really happened. And so then he understands that the angel came and rescued him. And then he goes to the house. Now, I just want to make a note here in verse 12. We're told that the house he goes to is the house of Mary, who is the mother of John, also called Mark. This person is important for us to know. This is John Mark. And he will see him show up a couple of times later in the next few chapters here in the book of Acts. This is the writer of the Gospel of Mark. His name was John Mark. And he was a close disciple or follower of Peter. And so when we look at the Gospel of Mark, the common belief is that it was written by this man, John Mark, that he wrote kind of like Peter's eyewitness account. So John Mark writes down all of the things that he learns mostly from Peter, although as we'll see in coming chapters here, he will accompany Saul and Barnabas for a time too, and get some of his information also, just from them. But most of what Mark writes in his gospel is the eyewitness account of Peter. And so I just think that's kind of interesting. Now we're introduced to this person for the first time. Mark is the first gospel, by the way, that was written, even though it doesn't appear first. In the New Testament, they don't appear like in the order that they were written. Mark was the first one that was written. And Luke, who wrote the book of Acts, and Matthew based both of their gospels on a lot of the information that was in Mark too. All right, so it's just kind of a little sideline that's interesting. So the people had gathered together in one place and they were praying for Peter's release. And so he goes up and he knocks on the door, and this poor woman comes to the door and recognizes Peter's voice. I think it's kind of funny that she runs back in and leaves him standing open the door. They're like, open the door, let him in. She's like, I know it's him. I heard his voice. And I'm like, well, of course, nobody believes that it's him. And she's like, yeah, I recognized his voice. And I'm scratching my head going, well, why didn't you let him in?
Well, when you're so dumbfounded at a miracle, like, all logic goes out the window, quite honestly.
Yeah.
Or just any situation where you're literally dumbfounded.
Well, and I think probably part of the reason here is that they are probably assuming that Peter is dead, or is beaten. So, I mean, they're certainly not expecting that Peter's going to be out of prison. Remember, what they've seen now is that Herod has put James to death and arrested Peter. And so they're probably all thinking, oh, Peter is doomed. And they're gathered together and praying. Lo and behold, their prayers are effective and answered. And, but that's not what they're expecting. I think it's kind of interesting that when she keeps insisting that it's Peter, they respond by saying it must be his angel. And I think it's important for us to clarify here. They say that because they operate under the belief that every person has an angel who's kind of assigned to watch over them. And we still kind of follow this line of thinking as well, don't we? Everybody has a guardian angel. And so they're thinking that it is Peter's guardian angel who is standing outside of the door. Contrary to what maybe some people might be thinking, is that they thought that Peter was dead and had turned into an angel. That's not it at all.
And yet they didn't let the guardian angel in the door.
Maybe they expected the guardian angel could walk through the door. But yeah, so he keeps knocking, and finally they open the door and they let him in, and they're all astonished and overjoyed. And then he quiets them all down and then tells them exactly how he got out of prison. And then he says, tell James and the brothers about this. And then he leaves for another place. Who is James? This is James. Go ahead, Olivia.
I was like, I know, my commentary says it's the brother of Jesus.
Yes. Yeah, good job. So this is not the James that we're told about earlier, who The James that we're told about at the beginning of the chapter, the brother of John, was an original disciple or follower of Jesus. Pretty much most Christian historians understand or believe that James, the brother of Jesus, was not initially a follower or a disciple of Jesus until after his death and resurrection. And then he becomes a disciple and follower of Jesus and actually becomes a leader in the early Christian church. And we'll see that throughout the book of Acts here. He'll kind of start figuring more as a leader of the church in Jerusalem.
I have a question because maybe it is in the Bible, but I don't remember it ever being. So Mary became pregnant again and had James.
Depends on who you ask.
I was like, or is he adopted? Or so the record I see is only that Mary had one child.
No, and there are others referred to in other places in the Gospels. James and Joses are mentioned by name, as is a sister, Salome, are mentioned. The Roman Catholic Church, and I believe the Greek Orthodox Church as well, believe that Mary remained a virgin until her death. And they believe that these other individuals who are named as brothers and sisters of Jesus in the Bible were either step siblings, that they were children of Joseph from a previous marriage, or that they were cousins. That's not the Lutheran or Protestant understanding. We believe that Mary and Joseph did have other children after Jesus together, and that James was one of those, as well as Joses and Salome. James also writes, there's a letter in the New Testament, the New Testament letter of James, and that's this James.
I don't know why people wouldn't believe that, because they were human. I mean, Jesus was divine, but they were still human beings who were married.
Yeah, it's been a point of controversy between the Roman Catholic Church and the Orthodox churches, and then the Protestant churches. It's one of those things that, you know, in the grand scheme of things, it shouldn't
be.
Yeah, it probably, it's just not one of those things that matters a whole lot. I mean, it does, but it doesn't, so.
I guess I've just never met anybody who's like, no, you know, yeah. It would be interesting to talk to someone who believes that point of view, that Mary was the only one, like, had only one child, and that was Jesus, but I'm like.
All right, so that's kind of that account then. And then, obviously then in the morning, there's a commotion at the prison because the guards wake up and he's not there. So there's a problem. And then because they didn't find him, because he had somehow escaped, Herod has the guards executed. So then we move on into this kind of interesting ending of chapter 12. And I'll go ahead and read that, because this is where things get weird. Yeah.
Before you do, though, because I've just been waiting. I made an interesting observation that was pointed out to me by my commentary. I guess a lot of people wonder how Peter could just sleep so soundly in between two guards. And my commentary makes a reference to Psalm 127:2, which says he gives his beloved sleep, and that Peter had nothing to be anxious about because he knew that God would take care of him, and that we can't worry about the iron gate before we get to it.
I like that.
did too.
Yeah, I like that a lot. And I think that's a really good point. Peter doesn't seem to be worried about anything. And I think
it's, I mean, he's escaped before too, with God's help.
Yeah.
Which is why I wondered why they specified four squads of four soldiers. And I was like, oh, it's because he's escaped before.
And
they needed more guards.
And it's important to remember too that the people are gathered and they're praying for him. I think that's the other thing that's important. Yeah. Okay. Carolyn, anything on any of that from you?
No.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to pick up in the second half of verse 19 here then. Then Herod went from Judea to Caesarea and stayed there a while. He had been quarreling with the people of Tyre and Sidon. They now joined together and sought an audience with him. Having secured the support of Blastus, a trusted personal servant of the king, they asked for peace because they depended on the king's country for their food supply. On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robes, sat on his throne and delivered a public address to the people. They shouted, "This is the voice of a god, not of a man." Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. But the word of God continued to increase and spread. When Barnabas and Saul had finished their mission, they returned from Jerusalem, taking with them John, also called Mark. All right, so Herod has a problem. And it's interesting. I was, so when you go to Israel, this place in Caesarea where Herod dies is still, the ruins are amazingly preserved and there. And so you can see that like amphitheater and stuff where it's purported that this incident happened. So these people of these kind of northern regions who they've been having conflict with Herod up until now, they realize we need to have a better relationship because they need food and supplies and those kinds of things. And so they're seeking to kind of get
a kiss his butt.
So, yeah, kiss his butt and get a better a relationship with him. And so they do that and they're gathered all together in this large amphitheater in this area. And he's dressed all up in his royal robes and everything and makes this wonderful speech. And then they all start making these comments about how he is like a god and not a man. Well, Herod is a very self-centered, egotistical person, and he doesn't turn around and give glory to God. And so because of that, he is struck dead and he's eaten by worms. It's a very gruesome death that happens right there in public. And he dies. And I think we're told about this for two reasons. I think number one, because Herod had personally attacked the disciples and you know, ordered the killing of James. I think the other reason is because he sets himself up as a god. He does not acknowledge Yahweh as the one true God, and this is dangerous, and God is just done. And so he sends Michael, then the angel of the Lord. Again, we see this, strikes him down, and Herod's done. But that does not stop the gospel from being struck, because then the very next sentence here is, but the word of God continued to increase and spread. So the gospel continues to spread, even though it's continuing to come up against all of these kind of like roadblocks, religious roadblocks and political roadblocks. It's continuing to be spread. And then again, we're kind of told then that John Mark joins now, Saul and Barnabas. And that's important now as we move into the next couple of chapters, because the next couple of chapters will focus on the mission and ministry of Saul and Barnabas and John Mark. Okay, any questions on any of that kind of stuff? Nope. Okay, so I said I had a song to play that is based on this. I love when we get songs that are based on scripture, but this has been one of my favorites for a very long time. And Olivia, you'll recognize this the minute I start playing it. And I bet you probably already know what I'm going to play. So I'm going to play just a portion of this. Can you guess?
Forget the name of the song.
I know.
Is it with the Sticks? Do you know what I'm talking about?
No. But that's okay.
Where they stand there in their robes with their sticks?
Oh, no. No, that's a Mind Focus. Yeah, that's a good one, too. Yeah.
Bummer.
Here we go. Oh. Wait a good play.
Oh.
Peter tried to sleep, but beyond the walls an endless prayer was lifting for his keep. Then a light cut through the darkness of a lonely prison cell, and the chains that bound the man of God just opened up and fell. And running to his people before the break of day, there was only one thing on his mind, one thing to say. Angels watching over me, every move I make.
Okay.
I like that song.
I do too. One of my
favorites. I know the whole thing.
The name of the song is called Angels, and it is performed here by Amy Grant. And so if you want to listen to the rest of it, it's just an outstanding song. But really, she just quotes this particular passage just almost perfectly. The thing I love about this song is it just kind of reminds us, you know, that God's always watching out for us. Angels are always watching over us. The last line of this song is especially important, I think, because she ends the song saying, though I never see with human eyes the hands that lead me home. And I think that's important for us to remember. God's always got us. It kind of goes along with what you said earlier, Olivia. Peter slept well because he knew he was in good hands. He knew he was being taken care of. All right. Any other comments or questions before we pray?
Yes.
Yeah.
I just realized my reading from Luke this week kind of ties into this passage, just because, what was it, Luke 12? And I read specifically 13 through 34. So if y'all want to look that up, I don't know exactly what type of which verse this references, but something I learned that was marked in my Bible for that goes in with this is that if you regard your material possessions as your treasure, then your heart is set here on this earth.
So in Luke 12, you said, or 13?
12. Verses 13 through 34. I'd read that passage.
Oh yeah, which is kind of like, the parable of the rich fool, the guy who has like so much money, and Jesus says, if you want to follow me.
I think it was more towards the end that my Bible
which
I thought was ties into like worrying about the iron gate and stuff. So if y'all are from, that's a great passage to read. I highly recommend it. Just because it's very easy to apply to today.
Yep. Especially starting at verse 22. which is similar to in Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, or actually this is in Matthew chapter 6, the Sermon on the Mount. And this is part of in Luke, it's called the Sermon on the Plain, but a lot of the same kind of concepts. And it's just this whole thing about not worrying and don't put our trust in the things of here, the material things. Put our trust in God. God will take care.
Oh yeah, it's specific, verse 34. That's right. Yeah. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Absolutely. Yep.
Yeah.
Good reminder.
I just realized I read a lot of good stuff that ties in together. I love it.
Isn't it great how that just God just makes those things work? All right, well, let's close our time together with a word of prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for the gift of this day and for the opportunity once again to dig into your word and to learn and study and grow together. We ask that you bless us now as we go our separate ways, that you help everybody have a great week, that you keep us strong and united in your word. And Lord, help us to remember the wonderful lesson here that we can sleep soundly and not worry because you have everything under control. You are taking care of us and you will provide for all of our needs. We pray this in the holy and precious name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, well, have a good week, everybody. Thank you for joining us, and we will see you next week when we'll start again with probably another hilarious joke.